You're doing something different. Explain to us what space you occupy in the sort of AI ecosystem and where you are in your journey as a company.
Yeah, we, from the very beginning, we decided to not focus on B2C and focus on the most critical and complex processes and use cases. So that means health and legal, finance, but also government. And this was the reason why we built our own data center. And this was the reason why we, from the very beginning, kind of worked with different partners. And the last funding round is really just kind of a consequent of all that.
And so tell me exactly how you, what you're doing sort of helping them, right? Because these are governments, these are companies. Yep. We understand ChatGPT, we type it in. Most people are doing, I guess, their homework on ChatGPT these days. So what are you doing for these companies? Explain to us how this sort of slots in. Mm-hmm.
So think about you want to write a quarterly report. So it's based on very confidential data. You can afford no mistake. It has to be top-notch. So you cannot just paste all your internal documents into something like ChatGPT and say, write a quarterly report. Or let's say you're in legal, where every question there's hardly ever one clear answer. There's always this perspective, and then this perspective, and then this evidence, and then this conflicts with that. And so you need different UX. You need to be in an environment that's secure. So you really need have different requirements from what a ChatGPT can offer you.
And are you discovering sort of new and surprising use cases with these companies as you're discovering kind of what it can do?
Well, we're learning a lot, right? I'm not an expert in manufacturing. So in the last months, I learned a lot about manufacturing and about how semiconductor companies and engineering companies, how they're going about their business and what makes them excellent and how we can help there. And this is something we develop with them together.
Do you find it annoying a little bit that OpenAI and ChatGPT sort of dominates the public consciousness on the conversation around AI?
Well, it also helped us a lot, right?
Yeah.
Kind of funding round and this visibility for this industrial revolution would not have been there if it wasn't for OpenAI. So it's a blessing and a curse, mm-hmm. right? It's like a curse because we're competing against them as well.
Right, and you're also competing with companies that are backed by absolute giants, the biggest companies on the planet. What do you see the risk of sort of AI monopolies? And what do you think, if those come to pass, what is the consequence of that?
I mean, that's the play, right? That's the play why these giant companies are investing or are partnering with these companies is they want to dominate the future. They want to do what has been done for the cloud market. They want to do this for the intelligence market. And for the intelligence market, it will be much more severe because AI will also influence our thinking, will influence the next generations and how they grow up and how they learn. So I think this is, on a sovereignty perspective, much more critical than every other industry.
And you've taken me right to where I want to go, which is European tech sovereignty. I know that you think that this is very important. I'd like how important is it for you guys to be funded fully out of Europe? And is it possible, as time goes on, for you to be fully funded out of Europe?
So we're not fully funded out of Europe. Our friends at Hewlett Packard Enterprise, mm-hmm. Which we've been working on for years, with a great way. But yeah, we're mostly funded out of Germany, out of Europe. And this is just kind of one side of sovereignty. Funding sovereignty, like where's the value, how do you control certain developments. It's an important part. But the other part is what we're giving our customers. We're working with U.S. customers as well, and they also worry about their sovereignty. There's big U.S. enterprises, and they also know that if they hand over all the control, all the data, all the ownership to some monopoly player, they're in a difficult position as well.
So are you looking to raise more money? And what kinds of people are you talking to in terms of investors? Because it's different than the traditional investors that many of your competitors would be.
Yeah, it's different, right? Yeah. It's a very different and very unique funding round. I think we haven't had something like that at all, really, in Germany. And yeah, we will be raising more capital, but this year is all about execution. So there's some conversations happening, but I'm hoping that this year I can focus on tech. I can talk more with professors and less with investors.
And what you also need is an ecosystem, right, in Europe. And so we talked about the money side of it. There's also the question of regulation. There's also the question of talent. There's a question of chip manufacturing, all these sorts of things. What is the most important thing that is missing right now in the European AI sort of ecosystem?
So I think the most critical thing in Germany and Europe is putting the technology into action. This was even before Gen AI. Germany was lacking behind on applying AI and actually making use out of that. And I think this will be critical, not only for our survival, but also for the survival of these great companies that we have in Germany and Europe.
Yeah, and I talked to many of these great companies, a lot of the industrial companies. I talked to, for example, Siemens, right, a historically industrial giant. But they're saying that basically the future of Germany is not heavy industry. It needs to rely on its sort of educational, its innovation, its technology. That is you. If you were to give some advice to the government, who is obviously trying to foster that kind of environment here in Germany, what are the principles that should guide their policymaking to attract companies like you and to ensure your success?
So I think we don't need subsidies. Yeah. What we need is a level playing field. So we need somewhat fair, like a fair environment. And this is difficult because the big players run monopoly chains, so they can use one monopoly really to kind of endlessly fund the fight for dominance in like a new era, which is challenging for new players. Mm. And then on the government side of things, our government is, there's 400,000 open positions in government. And right. the demography is horrible. Like in the next few years, we'll fall off a cliff. Yeah. So what we need from government is really, they need to modernize. And they can do this with AI, of course. Mm-hmm. Right? We would all be happy about that. But we need a government that works. We need a government that is lean. And we need a level playing field.
And then the AI Act out of Brussels, you presumably have been involved in some of these conversations, I would assume. What are the strengths and the weaknesses of the AI Act?
So the strength is that it's finally somewhat done.
Yeah.
So the uncertainty is gone. I don't think that is necessarily the good move as like the last in place, like behind the US and behind China in like the, using AI, growing AI, to be the first on heavy regulation. Mm-hmm. I think we all the creative energy that we have in Germany and Europe, we need this for innovation. And now we're diverting some of that towards compliance, which I don't think is ideal.
Right.
But the AI, as it is fine.
And the question is also, you know, how different is it now as a consequence of this pursuing AI in Europe versus the United States? And you've also talked about going into the United States.
Yeah. Well, I mean, there have been different drafts and different ideas, and yeah. there was never really like one direction. There's different ideas. And what we've seen is that kind of on the last meters of before the finishing line, there was like Germany, France, Italy coming in and saying, hey, wait a minute, we do have strong AI companies. We have Aleph Alpha, but we also got Mistral in France. We got some others rising up. So maybe we don't want to crush all that new innovation. So let's be a little bit careful with what we're doing here.
Right. I want to talk just quickly about the macro, because there's a lot of speculation about what the impact of AI is going to be on the macro. This is a year where there are a huge number of elections going on in democratic countries. I want to get your perspective. I know that's not what you're involved in, but kind of the ability of AI now is sort of more democratically available to identify, target voters, and to inflame people. How do you see that kind of trickling through the electoral process?
So the general problem with AI is it gives humans superpowers.
Yeah.
So it gives superpowers to great humans, right? It gives superpowers to people in manufacturing and research, and that's awesome, right? But it also gives superpowers to people that want to influence elections, that want to bring people down, that want to do like crime. We've already seen AI automating like blackmailing and cybercrime. So I think that's something where, unfortunately, criminals and totalitarian regimes are often the very first that are using these opportunities. I think that's a danger for liberal democracy as a whole.